We will talk about interest rates because it is very interesting in the context of understanding the money and its pricing. In that context, interest is a payment made by the borrowers for the use of sum of money for a period of time. It is one of the four types of incomes that anyone can have it, the others being rent, wages, profit, and interest is one of the earnings provided we have the money to invest and we get back the price of that money. And interest has three elements. First is it covers the risk. Second, it covers the risk of lending and then payment for the intermediation cost, and then the pure interest for the use of money of the lender. So there are three elements to the interest rates. One is it covers risk, second is the intermediation cost, and third is the pure cost of money, that is the pure interest for the use of the money. Interest rate is an intersection between supply and demand for the loan, because the funds should be available at any point of time for lending, and the borrower should have the access of money at a given point of time, and the price will be decided by the demand and availability of money. But these three elements an entrepreneur will have to keep in mind, and the interest rates are always an intersection of these three elements, and one has to keep in mind. Then there are different economists who have put in different types of theories for determining the rate of interest for the money. And Fisher and other classical economists considered money as a simple means of payment or medium of exchange, whereas Keynes has laid emphasis on the store of value. Because when the story of money begins, then the first usage of money was a means of only exchange. Later on, when it developed, then it has gained a store of value because the money should be stored for a future use, and then its storage has a cost element, because when you are holding the cash, then you have to pay for it. So it has a store of value. But then at the same time, when the exchange of money has evolved over a period of time and new dimensions have been added, then Keynes has added a new dimension to the money, that one can have a speculative purpose beyond the exchange value and store of value. So speculative purpose is when the money is in short supply, then you can make more money out of the interest, and you will be looking for an opportunity to make more money out of the same money by holding it for some time till the market is favorable to you. That is the way speculative purpose is being seen. And then the shift of demand according to the preference between money, and then one more thing has been added by Keynes. That is, in a simplistic form, anyone would be holding the cash or in the form of bond. Because when the bonds from the money, when we have moved into the market and bond as a concept has entered, then Keynes was of the opinion that anyone would like to hold liquid form of money and also some portion as a bond. Now, why anyone would like to have in the form of a bond? Because bonds will be less liquid, it will have a dimension of risk of non-payment. So if someone is keeping the money in bond, he would definitely expect more interest, because he has to cover the three elements, that is the risk, then the cost of transaction, and the third one is the cost of pure cost of the money. these three elements should be there in the bond, whereas the money, if it is kept in the form of currency, then it will have no interest, and one has to keep it in the liquid form for a future use. Hence, anyone would like to hold the money in two components, money and bond, in the ratio in which his requirements are met. Like if you look at any of the entrepreneur or for the banks also, the cash on hand will always be less, and the cash in the bank or cash in the form of investments in bonds and other securities will be more, for the reason that anyone would like to earn interest out of the investment of the money. So money and bond is the simplistic form of two options which the which Keynes has thought of, and then he has he is of the opinion that anyone would like to keep the money in the two formats, that is the in cash or in the form of bond. And then he has come out with a liquidity preference theory. Liquidity preference theory is a very simple format of the theories of interest rates. What he says is, when the demand and supply, the preference for investment in bond or the money changes with the interest rate movements in the market, and hence the preference for liquidity will change with the change in the interest rates in the market. Whereas again, Hicks and Hans, they have come out with an advanced version of interest rate theory, that is investment and savings and liquidity and money preference curve. This concept we will discuss as we go forward. IS curve, that is the investment and savings curve, will decide the preference of the entrepreneur to put in money. The slope and position of LM curve will decide. So as we go ahead, we will discuss it in detail, and the intersection of the IS and LM curves will determine the interest rate at any particular point of time, and the income levels also play a greater role in determining the interest rates. Now we will come to Keynes' liquidity preference theory of rate of interest. What he says is, money will always be in demand in the society for various purposes. For that, what anyone would look at is the interest rate and the needs and his needs, because the needs have to be met first, and then whatever extra income will be there, that will be put in the bonds or various securities. So at any particular point of time, the liquidity preference is always the particular, it has to be different for the different people, because the perception and the needs for the money will be different for different individuals. Hence, the liquidity preference will shift from one basket of entrepreneurs to another basket of entrepreneurs. And what is the deciding factor is the availability of money. Then when the equilibrium is, when the demand and supply, there is an equilibrium, that is the midpoint, that is the rate at which the money will be available at a given point of time. And the effects of increase in money supply, money at any particular point of time, if it is taken as constant, then the interest rate will shift according to the preference of the people, and only the preference of the people will shift the interest rates. Whereas if the money flow, that is the money is not constant, then both the money and the interest rates will start shifting from one point to another point, and the shift in demand curve or liquidity preference curve will decide the interest rates. So two things will be very clear in the case of Keynes. First is, So long as the preference of people is towards earning more interest, then he would like to keep the money in bonds and he will have less cash with him, and the demand curve will shift the moment the interest rates move at any particular point of time. But if the supply of money is not constant, then in that case both the money supply and the preferences will simultaneously shift the positions and will move the interest rates. So this is how the interest rate theory of Keynes works, that the interest rate shifts with the supply of money and the preference of the people to keep the money in different pockets, that is in the bonds and the money market. Now, when we come to the simplistic format of Keynes' theory of interest, according to him, the rate of interest is purely a monetary phenomenon and is determined by the demand for money and supply of money. It is a very simple phenomenon. The theory is known as liquidity preference theory. Liquidity preference in the sense that whether one would like to hold it in the form of cash or he would like to hold it in the form of bonds, because in the case of bonds, the interest rate will be high, will be more, whereas in the case of cash, there may not be any interest rate if it is kept in a account like savings, like a current account, where there is no interest rate. But if someone keeps the money in savings, then of course the interest rate is there. But suppose he puts in the bonds or in a fixed deposit, then the interest rate will be higher. So supply and when we analyze the supply and demand, and explain the rate of interest as a price determined for the money and the supply of availability of loans, then the concept will be very clear. That it very clearly explains that the interest rate is the price of money, and the interest is the reward for parting with the liquidity for a specified period of time. When we borrow from the market for a specified period, we get the money, and we will have to part with some price for the towards the reward for parting with the liquidity for that particular period of time. Because anyone who is having cash or who is having liquidity would like to lend only if he gets the interest for that, and it covers the three elements which we have discussed earlier. That is the risk of lending, number one. Number two is the intermediation cost, that is the transaction cost. In the case of banks, the transaction cost may be around 2.5 to 3%, but in the case of individuals, it may not be so. So depending on that, the second element is the transaction cost, and third is the pure interest for towards a reward for parting with the liquidity for a specified period of time. So all these three he has synchronized into the preferential theory, where he propounds that anyone would like to follow a pattern in preferring the different types of investments. And Keynes assumed that in a simplified economy, there will be two assets, that is money and bonds. And which people keep in their portfolio balance. But now, of course, we have a host of other securities in which we can hold the money. But basically, in a simplistic format, only two forms of investments are seen. One is in the form of cash, and second is the bonds. Money in the form of currency and current deposits in the bank, which earn no interest. And second is the long-term or the short-term or medium-term bonds, for which the quotes are available in the market. Rate of interest and bond prices are inversely related. The higher the interest, the lower will be the tendency for the bond prices to come down. And the higher the current interest rates, the lower the yields, and vice versa. Yields are based on the concept of residual value of money. And that is the reason why when the interest rate moves up, the yields come down. The yields come down for the reason that the residual period for which the money is held in the bond and the interest rate, both are seen as a reward for the money that is held in the bonds. So that is the reason why the yields and interest rates are inversely proportional to each other. And the quantity of demand, quantity of money demanded increases with the fall in the rate of interest, because naturally when the funds are cheap, there will be more demand for funds, and in the level of it is also related to the level of nominal income of people. If the income is more, there is a tendency to spend more, and there is a tendency to have more in the form of cash. The position of money curve depends upon two factors: the level of nominal income and the expectation about changes in the bond prices in the future, which implies change in the rate of interest in the future. Because in a given environment, always the price of money shifts from one point to another, for the reason that never the market conditions are static. They are always dynamic, and the price of money moves in tandem with the market forces, and hence equilibrium of demand curve of money is very important to understand. When the quantity of money demanded equals the money supply fixed by the monetary authority at a certain rate of interest, it is said to be in equilibrium. But such equilibrium is very difficult to reach in a very dynamic market environment, because the market conditions differ, preferences of the people differ, and the demand for money changes from one point of time to another. If the rate of interest is lower than equilibrium, the demand for money rises and equals at the point where it meets the perceived rate of interest. Thus, the increase in money supply leads to fall in rate of interest. So it is a very interesting intersection between the rate of interest and supply of money, and the preferences of the people to borrow or to lend or to put money in different securities that are in the bonds and other securities. So it is always it is very always dynamic to see that the interest rates keep moving in the system, and it is very difficult to draw an equilibrium position where the money supply will be constant and interest rate will be constant. So that point is difficult to attain, but suffice it to understand that the demand for money and the rate of interest keeps moving from one point of time to another point of time according to the perceived preferences of the money market. So that we should always keep in mind. As demand for money, that is liquidity preference, is inversely related to the rate of interest, the money demand curve at a given level of income will show a downward slope. When we see the slope, it will always be showing downward. The higher the interest, the lower the demand for money, and higher the demand for bonds. Naturally, when the interest rates are higher, then lower will be the demand for money, and higher will be the demand for bonds, because the propensity to earn more is always inherent in the market. Even if the future outlook of interest rate is higher, it impacts the spot money and the demand for bonds. So when the interest rates move up, then the demand for bonds move up, because they perceive that the interest earnings on the bonds will be much higher in the future, and hence it is preference, the preference will be towards buying more bonds. So shift in money demand will take place from time to time. The position of money demand curve depends on two factors: the level of nominal income and the expectations about changes in the bond prices in future, which we have seen, and which signals change in the interest rate. shift in money demand curve or Keynes liquidity preference curve can also be caused by the change in the expectations of the people regarding interest rates and bond prices. So if we see in a holistic way, what Keynes says is the preference of the people keeps changing with the movement of money supply and the bond prices and the interest rates, and nothing is static in a given market scenario, and the preference keeps changing, and the equilibrium point is the point at which the demand for money and the interest rates meet each other. So that is what makes the interest rate study very interesting. Now, taking forward this interest rates study and the theories of interest rates, the classical economists talked about interest rates on the money on the premise that it is a holding a value for exchange only, whereas Keynes has brought the concept of store of value, and he also brought the concept of speculative value for the money. So these three concepts were brought compared to the classical economists, who have only thought of limiting to the exchange value of the money. But then Hicks, a renowned economist Sir John Richard Hicks and Alvin Hansen, have propounded a synthesis between classical views and the Keynesian theories of interest, and thereby have succeeded in propounding an adequate and determined theory of interest through intersection of what are called IS and LM curves, whereas IS is known as investment and savings curves, and LM is the liquidity preference and money supply equilibrium curves. He has put together the two theories and has evolved what is known as Hicks model, that is the Hicks theory. And this is very interesting for the reason that it fuses the concept of classical economists and the views of Keynesian model, and takes it forward to bring out a new concept which is called IS and LM curves most popularly. And with the intersection of IS and LM curves, both interest and income are simultaneously determined. Whereas the income concept is not very clear in the case of Keynesian theory. Now, here the four factors are very, very important. First is the preference for investment, the preference for savings, and the preference for money supply, and the demand for money in the given point of time. These four factors he has put together to bring out the concept. And IS curve tells us what would be various rates of interest at different levels of income, because as the levels of income change, the preference for holding the money will change, for the reason that with the lifestyle changes, with the consumption pattern undergoing a change, the preferences of the people to hold money for various purposes will be different. And in the given circumstances, the investment demand curve and family of saving curves at different levels of income will undergo change according to the income level. The concept of income level has not been very clearly brought out by Keynes, but Hicks has brought out the concept that the income levels also has a direct influence on determining the interest rates. The IS curve and LM curve relate the two variables, income and the rate of interest. Whereas what he brought out is the money and the cost of money and the demand for money, which determines the interest rate. But in the case of IS and LM curve, both they relate to each other with income and the rate of interest. The intersection point of these two curves is the equilibrium rate of interest. Now what he says is, Hicks says that when IS and LM, the two curves, they meet each other, that determines the point of interest rate, And it is much more refined when compared to Keynesian model of interest rate theories. But in any given interest rate theory, one very glaring thing which comes out is the money is having different features, and for the money there is a price and there is a demand in the market, and the demand in the market creates the value for money, and there is a price for the money which is very important from the point of any of the economists who have brought out the theories of interest rates. And we have to always keep in mind that the interest rates move in the market on the basis of two or three factors. One is the most essential is the availability of liquidity. Second is the demand for money. Third is the preferences of the people. And the fourth one which Hicks brought out is the savings and the income levels. Income levels have not been brought out by Keynes, which he has brought out. And he says that with the change in the income levels, the preferences of the people for different usages of the money will undergo a change, and hence it will undergo a change in the case of interest rates as well. And classical economists consider money only as a means of exchange that we have seen earlier, and Keynes has brought assumptions of two asset economy, that is the money and the bonds, that led to liquidity preference theory as a store of value and the speculative value, which we have seen. And the interest rate in that case is the intersection between the demand and supply of money at any given point of time, whereas the Hicks and Hansen brought out a semblance between the views of views and investment and savings, and brought the concept of IS and LM. And he says that the intersection between these two curves will decide the interest rates. IS and LM relate to two variables, income and rate of interest, and defines its intersection point as the equilibrium rate of interest. So one is an improvement over the other, beginning with the classical economists, moving to the Keynesian economy, Keynesian views, and third is the Hicks model. But all put together are of one common view, that the interest rate is always dynamic. It depends on the demand at any particular point of time. It also brings to focus the preferences of the people changing at different points of time with the change in the income levels, and hence all these put together brought one common feature, that the preferences keep changing and the interest rates are always dynamic.